Well, good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Wiley Drake Show. We're live on the air with you right now on the CCC, which is the Congressional Communications Channel. We're hoping to hear from some folks in Washington, D.C. As you see me here on television, you see me standing not in my usual business suit uniform. You see me standing in what is referred to as an orange jumpsuit. I'll explain that a little bit in just a moment. A dear pastor friend of mine, Patrick Mahoney, Pat Mahoney, is doing the same thing right now as we speak, thousands of miles away in our nation's capital, standing outside of the Rayburn Building there on Capitol Hill. Pat Mahoney and some other folks are sharing as well. I want to read for you their press release and tell you about it. It says the Orange Jumpsuit Campaign to hold a prayer vigil and public witness before Pastor Saeed's wife testifies in front of the Congressional Committee this Tuesday morning, and that's right now. You can contact Reverend Pat Mahoney. He's at the Church on the Hill at 540-538-4741. The Orange Jumpsuit Project is an international campaign challenging churches, Christians, religious freedom advocates, and all people of goodwill to stand in solidarity with the persecuted church around the world. One of the ways to accomplish that is having supporters wear orange ribbons, articles of clothing, and even orange prison jumpsuits, as I have on and Pat has on, to draw attention to the violence and persecution directed against Christians around the world. You can link to a national news story by simply going to pound or hashtag Orange Jumpsuit Campaign. Activists are gathering right now in front of the Rayburn Building at 9 a.m. already, and now it's 10, before the hearing begins as we speak. And I want to begin our meeting with the shofar as they begin their meeting. Trumpet for the battle call, the battle sound, and I hope you'll come. Pat Mahoney and some of his friends and family are there at Washington, D.C., right outside the Rayburn House Office Building. As they gather for a public and prayer witness, some will be wearing these jumpsuits, some will just be wearing a yellow ribbon, or an orange ribbon, excuse me, and they will also be joined by concerned Muslims. Nagme Abedini, the wife of Saeed Abedini, will be testifying before the House Committee on Foreign Affairs, calling for the release of Americans being held in Iran. The chairman of that committee is my congressman, Ed Royce. I'm just a few miles from his office here in Orange County. Mrs. Abedini's husband, Pastor Saeed, who is an American citizen, has been imprisoned in Iran for almost 1,000 days. In fact, the matter is, the date for that anniversary, for the 1,000 days, is coming up on the 23rd day of this month. And so Reverend Mahoney, pastor of the Church on the Hill and founder of the Orange Jumpsuit Campaign, here's what Patrick says, and I would repeat it for you. Congress and the world cannot be silent as we witness this faith-based genocide and persecutions of Christians around the world. The global community must not be indifferent to the crushing of religious freedom. We also pray and call for Congress to block any Iranian nuclear deal while Pastor Saeed and other Americans are being unjustly held in Iran. The Republican Muslim Coalition says we stand in solidarity with Naghma Abedini and her family. We urge President Obama to bring Pastor Abedini safely back to the United States. There is no compulsion in religion. We request the Iran regime help reunite Pastor Abedini and his wife. We've been talking recently about a threefold cord. I want to talk to you about a particular threefold cord, if I could, right now. The first cord is to wear something orange. Maybe you won't go to the extreme that Pat and I have. Maybe you'll only have a ribbon on your lapel. That's okay. We're not criticizing you, but simply, number one cord is to wear something orange in reference to the orange jumpsuit. Now, if you look on my lapel of this orange jumpsuit, you will see another symbol. It is the Nasrani symbol. That Nasrani symbol is the letter N in their alphabet, and so I'm wearing that today as well. Do we have a caller on the line?
Good morning, Mr. Reverend Mary Turner from Washington, D.C.
Good morning, Reverend Mary Turner, and blessings. You are live on the television with us now, your voice. I am wearing an orange jumpsuit here on television in California. Is there someone there with an orange jumpsuit? Amen. Well, ladies and gentlemen, we have Reverend Mary Turner on with us from just outside the Rayburn office building. Patrick Mahoney is there in his orange jumpsuit. Others are wearing orange. We're telling you to tie a threefold cord. Number one, wear something orange. Number two, put on the Nasrani pin that indicates we are in solidarity with the persecuted church. And number three, I'm going to begin something I want all of you to do. I have before me on my desk several oranges, and I have one that's been peeled, and I'm going to eat an orange right here in Orange County. And as I eat this orange, I'm going to let that signify that not only outside but inside, we're standing in solidarity with the persecuted church. We're broadcasting to you right now on television from Orange County, interestingly enough, and I'm partaking of an orange slice. I would encourage you, Mary Turner and those people are on duty, boots on the ground. And if you can't be there with them, when you have your orange today for breakfast or lunch, remember that Pastor Saeed has not had an orange to eat in over 3 years. They don't give them oranges in prison. But when you eat that orange, remember what a blessing that is to you. And remember Pastor Saeed and others that are being persecuted for Christ. And wear the Nasrani pin on your lapel. That's a thing that looks like a U with a dot in it, but that is the N letter of their alphabet. And that's the same symbol that they put on the homes when they burn them. That's the same symbol they put on someone they behead or they rape and so forth. So eat an orange today. Wear something orange. Wear the Nasrani pin, but be in solidarity for the persecuted church. Mary, what would you share with us before you pray?
Well, the hearings are, you know, just getting ready to start. They were scheduled from 10 to about 2. So for the next 4 hours, I would say, you know, be hovering in prayer, just those testifying today, which would be his wife and her attorneys, and, you know, praying for favor, particularly, you know, with the panel, with those that are hearing, that they will hear with a righteous ear, that they will hear with an ear to faith and action, to not only gather the information, but then be willing to do something with it. You know, as in the days of Francis Gary Power, which he was shot down in Russia, and that you could fly and spent 2 years in a Russian prison before Congress and JFK during that time. JFK and similar congressional hearings were responsible for getting him out. They finally exchanged 4 Russian prisoners that we had here, 4 Russian spies for Francis Gary Towers back in the 60s. So let's pray that our government will do something, you know, with these hearings today, that they will go far, far-reaching enough to bring him home.
Amen. Thank you, Mary, and we appreciate that. And we agree with you in that prayer. Folks, as we voice our opinions, as we voice our words, our thoughts, what should be and could be done, so forth, let us make sure that we anoint that with the Holy Spirit of God, that whatever we say is indeed a prayer. We have right now before you open the Congressional Communications Channel, the prayer channel. It's open around the nation and literally around the world. I am seated in the West Coast headquarters of the Congressional Prayer Conference in an orange jumpsuit. I am in Orange County, California, and I am eating an orange. All of this in a significant symbolism of standing with the persecuted church, and others are standing there in our nation's capital. From Orange County, our congressman, who is the chairman of that Foreign Relations Committee, that is Ed Royce, is also a resident of Orange County, also the chairman, and also a member, of course, of the United States House of Representatives. Did we have someone else join us on the line?
Donna there from Lynchburg, Virginia.
Thank you, Donna, for joining with us. Would you pray, please, for Nagmay? She is in the session. We don't know what time. It's a sort of an all-day thing. We don't know if they'll get to her testimony quickly or drag it out or whatever. But would you lead us in prayer from Virginia here to California and to Mary Turner there in D.C.? Would you lead us in prayer for our sister Nagmay Abedini? Yes.
And bless am I saying it right? Abdet.
Nagmay.
Nagmay.
It's Nagmay. Nagmay Abedini.
Nagmay.
And for Americans,
for
Americans, that's a
thank
tough
you
one to pronounce.
To her husband, for amen. Thank you for this opportunity, Lord, that she has to go before this conference, this meeting. And thank you for Ed Royce. May he have supernatural favor with the other members.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you for the influence that he has on their decisions. And Lord, I pray for Nagmay now that you would cover her with your peace.
Yes.
In the peace of God that passes all understanding, to keep her heart, her mind, and her body in Christ Jesus, Lord. Thank you, Lord. You said we'd open our mouths and you would speak to us, Lord.
Amen.
So we're asking you to do that for her today. And thank you that you've gone before her, Lord. We're trusting that you prepared the
hearts of the members of the committee to hear these words and to even tremble at these words, knowing that it's coming from you through her.
Yes, Lord.
And use it for good, Lord. We're expecting a miracle of deliverance for her husband, Saeed, as well as others, Lord, who are being held in unjustly, Lord. Do miracles.
Yes, Lord.
Signs and wonders that will bring others into the kingdom.
Yes.
Because of what they witness of the one true God. In the name of our Savior, Yeshua.
And Lord, we do thank you for this, our sister's prayer. And I'm reminded recently in one of the men who was persecuted in this country, not only is Saeed being persecuted in Iran, but we had a man here, Kent Hovind, that has been in jail for over 8 years. The charges were just recently dropped, and that indeed was a miracle. But they're still dragging their feet and letting him out of jail. He is still in jail as we speak. And in his transfer, he shared with us something I think that is very pertinent to what we're talking about here. He shared that in that transfer, because he was in an airport and so forth, he had for the first time in over 5 years been able to eat an orange. He had not had an orange in prison in over 5 years of his 8-year stay, and he was so happy to say, thank God I got to eat an orange today, the first time in 5 years. And I would remind myself, Lord, and each of these women and men on the line, that today, tomorrow, and in the future, when we eat of an orange, we have so many good fruits in our country, but one of those breakfast items is typically an orange or orange juice. And Lord, in the future, I pray that when I drink an orange juice or when I eat an orange, I would be reminded of the persecution of the persecuted church, of the orange jumpsuit program, and of the standing for the persecuted. So Lord, bless us and help us as we enjoy our orange and our orange juices. I pray, Lord, that you would remind us what a blessing we have, but also to remind us to pray for the persecuted all over the world. And we'll be careful to give you the praise and the honor. Anyone else like to share or lead us in prayer, go right ahead.
Gracious Father in heaven, as I'm here in Orange County, Father God, I just pray, Father God, for those that are being persecuted for glorifying your name and lifting you up, Father God. And I pray, Father God, for those that are taking a stand. I especially pray for Pastor Wiley and others, Father God, that are on the line, that are, Father God, that are willing to make this public, Lord God. Let the world know that this news that's going on. And in that good news, Father God, how your Holy Spirit is going to intervene and open up the eyes of these to the truth. Pray, Father God, for the safety of those like myself, the hitchhiker, that are crossing the nation to share the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And then, gracious Father in heaven, I pray for the churches that are willing to open their doors and exemplify the truth in the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord God, for each and every one. In the mighty name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, James L. McCullough, a.k.a. The Hitchhiker, and praise God for him and his travels around the nation. And I want to remind you, as we said, we can remember orange and orange juice. We can wear orange and all of these things to remind us. And then there's that little lapel pin that I wear that reminds me that that Nazrani pin symbolizes persecution. When they persecute a man or a woman and behead them and burn the churches, that mark, it looks sort of like a U with a dot in it, but that is the letter N in the Nazrani alphabet. And they put that on the people's bodies when they behead them. They put it on their bodies when they rape them. They put it on the church door, graffiti style, when they burn the church or when they burn a business that is Christian. The Nazrani symbol indicates they are a believer of Jesus the Nazarene. And if you'd like one of those pins to wear in your lapel, you can get them. There's two sources I know of. One is you can contact me. I have some. I'll be glad to get one to you. Or you can go to our dear friends there in Washington, the Family Research Council, FRC.org, FRC.org, and they have led us and give us the prayer called the Call to Fall. And before I have someone else pray, I would ask that we all agree with this prayer. And if you are in agreement with it, I would appreciate you saying amen in a moment. But I would also recommend you go to the website, and the website's real simple. It's two words and one number. The word call, C-A-L-L, and the number two, and F-A-L-L. And if you go there, it will ask you to join. It doesn't cost anything. They're not going to bug you. But it just is to say, I will pray. I'm in, and I will pray the call to fall. And the call to fall prayer that's been written based on Scripture, but written by men and women at the Family Research Council and recommended to us, says this, and I quote, I will answer God's call to fall on my knees in humility and seek his face in repentance so that he might forgive my sin and heal our land. If you go to calltofall.com, you'll see that in print. You'll see other things there as well. But I would encourage you to do that. Let us try and tie together a threefold cord here in prayer. A threefold cord as we eat oranges and drink orange juice. A threefold third cord, a second cord as we wear orange. And a third cord as we wear that Nazrani lapel pin. And as we pray together. And if you agree with that call to fall prayer, would you say amen?
Amen.
All right. Anyone else? Oh, thank you for that amen. And anyone else on the line that would like to lead us in a prayer or just make comments? Like I said, this is a prayer line, folks. It's worldwide. It's on television. It's from the studio, it's from the headquarters of the West Coast office of the Congressional Prayer Conference of Washington, D.C., as well as the headquarters for First Southern Baptist Church of Buena Park and Messianic Fellowship. So if you would like to share anything, go right ahead. The microphone is open to you.
Kansas, where there were thousands arrested, but anyway, you know, the courtroom was full of Christians in orange jumpsuits because that was our clothing attire while we were waiting to be arraigned. I think I was in about 7 days just waiting arraignment, but you know, God made a wonderful, incredible use of, you know, according to Romans 8:28, where he says, I'll use everything to work together for good.
Amen.
For those that love me and are called according to my purposes, but those orange jumpsuits really trigger, you know, great memories of sacrifice and then seeing what God would do.
Amen.
With that sacrifice.
Amen.
So I know that good things are coming out of it, and we just pray, Lord, that you will everything that this man has suffered, God, the persecution that's come because of your name. We say, use it, Father, for your glory. In Jesus' name, and may the media report fairly on it. We lift up to you all of the American media here, Lord. And
yes, Lord.
In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. And ladies and gentlemen, I would remind you again of a particular scripture in the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 4, verse 12. The Bible says that a threefold cord is hard to break. We And I hope you will join us in helping us tie another threefold cord that we're tying together in the near future. The first cord will be tied at 109 2nd Street Northeast, where we will have a special noontime prayer meeting for the persecuted church. And it will be on Saturday, June the 13th. Saturday, June the 13th, and you can tie that with us either by being there, boots on the ground, or prayer in the air. This prayer line will be open, and that will be on June the 13th. June the 13th on Saturday at 12 noon. And if you come to that and are boots on the ground, the Congressional Prayer Conference of Washington, D.C.'s chairman, Wiley Drake, yours truly, will buy you pizza for lunch. You do need to RSVP so I'll know how much pizza to get. We want to make sure we got plenty. But that's the first cord that you can help us tie. You can come and be there at 109 2nd Street Northeast in Washington, directly across the street from the Supreme Court, and have pizza with us. That's the first cord. The second cord you can tie the very next day. Our good friend, Coach Dave Dobemeyer, with an organization called saltandlightbrigade.org, is helping us tie the second cord of this threefold cord. The second cord is tied by saltandlightbrigade.org, and that will be on Sunday, the very next day, on Sunday the 14th at 12 noon. And we will be there at number 1 First Street on the steps of the United States Supreme Court. So we will tie the first cord on Saturday, the 13th, the second cord on Sunday, June the 14th, and then our dear friend and pastor in the Southern Baptist Convention that has led our convention so well is going to lead one of our final days of meeting. Our year ends in June, and we're going to be having our meeting there in Columbus. And on Tuesday evening, the 16th, our dear president has called for a national call for prayer to all Southern Baptists, all 15 million of us, for our next great awakening in our nation, and that will be Tuesday evening, June 16th. So June 13, June 14, and June 16 is the tying together of a threefold cord across denominational lines, across ethnic lines, across national lines, and I would encourage you to check that out. And if you want more information, just send me an email at wileywiley@att.net, wileywiley@att.net, and I'll send you a schedule for that threefold cord tying, and I would encourage you to be a part of it. And once again, you might not be able to go to Washington. You might not be able to go to Columbus, Ohio, but you can go and be prayer in the air by calling this prayer line number during those times as well as other times. Now, we are in a prayer session. We are honoring those that are being persecuted. We're praying for Nagma Abedini. We're praying for Ed Royce. We're praying for a lot of other people there. And that committee room, my understanding was, is that it would be standing room only, and they were not going to allow standing room. So if some of you that have been kicked out, not able to get in the room, you're certainly welcome to call us and share with us on this prayer line. Mary Turner can give you that number and access code. Anyone else like to share anything? Go ahead. And by the way, if you've already prayed, that's okay. Pray again. I've prayed several times. I've spoken a lot, but I want to open the phone line and the microphone line here on the Wiley Drake Show to you. So share what's on your heart. Just open your mouth and let God speak through you at this prayer meeting, would you please?
Lord, we know that there was in the spirit a stone that was thrown into the middle of the waters with our prayers. It went out from the field for heaven, to heaven, and saints that joined us from around the country through this radio program as we took communion there on the ground, and as we lifted the Jewish huppah marriage canopy in worship to you. The wind caught it and blew it, signifying the presence of your Holy Spirit, Lord, and that you are walking, you are answering prayers here in the Supreme Court, and you're bringing conviction, Holy Spirit, to the hearts of the justices that are even now making decisions in that case. So, Father, we just ask that your spirit of justice would fall in the Supreme Court today, as well as in the hearing room at the Rayburn Building. Room 2172, we ask, Father, let your spirit of justice blanket the hearts and the minds of all those there and bring conviction, Father, to our hearts, God, that we might be like Esther's, Lord, who Mordecai cried out to through his letters that he sent to her there as she was comfortable in the luxury of that palace. Lord, would you come into the comfort of our homes? Would you come in and invade the comfort of our businesses, Lord, our families? Would you come in, God, and cause us to be willing to rise up and to pay the price now for the next generation, Lord? If we come before your throne, Lord, we ask that that golden scepter would also be extended to us from your kingdom, that you are the King of heaven. You are the King of kings, and you rule. We say the government is upon your shoulders, Lord. So have your way, Lord, in the lives and hearts of the body of Christ, your bride. In Jesus' wonderful name we pray.
Father, I agree with my sister's prayer, and I remind myself as well as her that you teach us in your word that where two or more agree touching any subject, and she's just touched on one subject but many avenues, and I thank you for that, and I agree with that prayer, and I know, Lord, you're going to answer our prayer. You already have and already will, and we thank you for that. And the microphone is open. Anyone else would like to pray, pray again. Whatever the Lord lays on your heart, just speak what's on your mind that the Lord gives you. Would you please?
I was excited to hear that Donna from Lynchburg had joined us this morning, because it's been a long time since we've been on together, but this is Mary Turner here in Washington, Donna, and I've just been down in the Roanoke area for the better part of 4 months, beginning in February, for family members, funeral, and having family time there. And anyway, then as I came up to spend some time with the Lord and just be on a spiritual retreat in the Richmond area, one of the things he was encouraging me with, I saw in the realm of his impartation, showing me what was going to be taking place, I saw like a waterfall coming from Liberty Mountain there in Lynchburg, and I believe that that's one of the areas, you know, that God is special area, and I believe that his covenant, you know, his Joel 2 word that I'll pour out on my spirit upon sons and daughters in these end times, that he's got you there, you know, for such a time as this. And thank you for the prayer work and for holding the front lines there in Lynchburg, Virginia.
Well, we certainly do praise the Lord for Donna. She's a very faithful prayer warrior on this prayer line. Very busy woman, by the way. And busy for the Lord, and we thank the Lord for that. Anyone else like to lead us in prayer, go right ahead. While I'm waiting on some of you, I'm going to try to get in touch with Mr. I was going to try to get Alan Parker. I was hoping I'd be able to get him on the line. Good morning, caller. You there?
Well, I couldn't get off mute. Oh. Thank you, Mary. Yes, I have good memories when we were together standing on the wall. In D.C.
Yes, Dick Simmons and information yep. here in D.C. And
yeah, I'm happy to connect with you again, too. Yes, and thank you. I received that. He determines the boundaries of your location, and he's planted me here in Lynchburg. Such a time as this. So, Lord, may I hear your voice for any directives, for any assignments that you have for me to, for your purposes, for your glory.
Amen.
And Lord, I do thank you for, I mean, we're supposed to give thanks in all things. So,
amen.
Lord, I'm not real happy about what's going on with the Supreme Court decision situation, but Lord, thank you for helping us to focus, we your people, helping us to focus on marriage. And Lord, may we use this window of opportunity to examine our hearts, our lives,
amen.
Our
amen.
And your word, in light of your word. And Lord, we know what you say about divorce. I hate divorce. And yet the church, we your people, have been guilty of broken marriages, broken families, devastated children, and not fulfilling your purpose, your plan for marriage ourselves. So, Lord, may we humble ourselves before you, Lord, and before our spouse, and confess sins and see each other through your eyes, repent and forgive each other, Lord, and have new beginnings, Lord, renewal of wedding vows. May we fulfill your plan, your complete plan. It is one man, one woman, but it is for life. That's the promise we make, for better, for worse, until death do we part. Lord, show us what this looks like. You said you make a husband and wife one flesh. Lord, show us what that means, what it looks like, Lord, and what it entails. Help us, Lord. Help us to be what you want us to be within our marriages and our families, which we know is so foundational to everything. Lord, help us not be the problem. In the name of our Savior, Yeshua.
Well, I would just like to say amen to that, Sister Donna. And yesterday I was driving on the highway for a couple hours, in route to Richmond and back, and the radio program had a continuum of special guests, from Pastor Tony Evans to someone on James Dobson's program and others, and it was all on the topic of marriage, and it was so rich. I mean, it really gave
Hey, Pierre, hang on just a second, please.
You know, even about the battle that Adam and Eve had.
Mary, let me interrupt you just for a minute. Pierre Bynum, are you still there?
I am.
We're praying for Nagme Abedini outside the Rayburn Building as well as here in California. Ladies and gentlemen, you've heard me talk about FRC earlier and the call to fall. I want to ask Pierre Bynum to lead us in prayer for Nagme Abedini. Would you do that, my brother?
Our Congress, Lord, has voted that it must have the Yes.
This Christian man, and Lord, others, Lord, Americans being held against their will, Lord, without justice, without due process, and Lord, our nation does nothing. God, I pray for our congressmen, Lord, that they will not stop, Lord, that they won't just do resolutions, but Lord God, that they will draw lines, Lord, that require our president to take action, and Lord, that they will do what the president has not been willing to do, and that is to hold the line, Lord, on Iran, to say no to Iran, rather than continuing to plead with Iran to meet its desire for a deal, no matter how unequal it is for the U.S. and Lord, for the rest of the world. Lord, we have a responsibility for the
entire
world.
Yes, Lord. Yes.
And Lord, we have a responsibility for the entire world as far as religious liberty is concerned.
Amen.
Lord, you caused us to be the leader, Lord, in the whole matter of religious liberty. And Lord, under the current administration, we have abandoned that call and responsibility. We have ignored the law requiring this, Lord. And I thank you for Congress that they've stepped up to bat. Lord, they just recently passed a requirement that that any aid situations and trade decisions
right.
with foreign countries be that religious liberty practices be taken into consideration. Lord, we thank you for that. Now, Lord God, it's got to be followed through with, and it's got to be followed through with by our government. So, Lord, we pray for Nagme. Lord God, give her wisdom.
Yes,
Lord.
Let
her words be powerful from on high. Lord, let them ring, Lord, in the hearts and the minds of every member that's there, Lord, of the audience that's present, and Lord, not only of those members there, but across these United States. And Lord, to ring in the hearts and minds of Christian believers across America and around the world, and that they will rise and demand that Pastor Abedini be released, and he be released healthy, Lord, and strong, and that he
yes.
seems to be abused as he's been.
Yes.
So, God, we just ask you, I thank you for Wiley, Lord, organizing this prayer call. I pray that you'll bless these, Lord, that are standing before you today. In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Release Pastor Abedini, Lord. Let these prayers yes. lead to the release of Pastor Abedini. In the name of Jesus.
Amen. 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 Pierre, thank you so much. And to our audience there at the Rayburn Building, to our audience here in Orange County, California, I am in an orange jailhouse jumpsuit. Pat Mahoney is outside the Rayburn in an orange jumpsuit. And I'm reminding all of us, you might not be that led to do that, but almost all of you drink a glass of orange juice or eat an orange on a very regular basis. So we encourage you to participate in that, and remember Pastor Saeed Abedini when he is indeed in jail, when you have that orange or orange juice. Thank you, Pierre. God bless you. Someone else now like to lead us in prayer? Go right ahead.
Pierre, Donna Massenburg.
I think Pierre? I think we lost Pierre. Amen.
Call the fall coming, encouraging them to be part of that in their church at the end of the month, as well as to take the catalog of sins that Pierre Bynum had put together to use as a guide.
Amen.
Amen. Across the United States and through the churches, your people, Lord.
Amen. And I want to say thank you to Pierre. He doesn't hear me now. I don't think he's on, but he is such a busy man. He does so much for the Lord. And I don't say that to brag on him, but here I interrupted him right in the middle of his morning. It's 11 o'clock in the morning there in D.C., and we interrupted him. But he's so gracious to spend time with us in prayer and for Nagme and Pastor Saeed. And I just want to say thank you, Lord, for faithful men like Pierre Bynum and others who work so hard and so faithful. And now, for those of you on the prayer line, we have three audiences. We have the Rayburn Building. We have here the West Coast Headquarters of Congressional Prayer Conference, and the rest of the prayers in the air. So anyone else, if you'd like, the microphone is open to you. Go ahead.
I pray that we'll see participation in the call to follow by the pastors and the churches across America this year, like we've never seen before. We despise not small beginnings, and that, Lord, we recognize that we need your help. We need your Holy Spirit to convict the hearts.
Yes, Lord.
And convince the hearts of the pastors that this is very, very, very important, Lord, and be part of it.
Yes,
and
it is.
That it won't be just routine getting on our knees, which
Yeah.
Open our eyes to see what we need to pray. In the name of our Savior, Yeshua.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. And like I said, I would remind you, as you drink a glass of orange juice or eat an orange, it's been a long time since these men and women that are in prison have had the luxury of something that we take so for granted. I was able just to walk across the store, all across the street, and pick up a bag of oranges just quickly. And we take that so for granted. And Lord, when we do that in the future, help us remember their persecution. Whether we see someone like crazy old pastor in an orange jumpsuit or Pat Mahoney, or we see somebody with a little ribbon in their lapel, or we see somebody with a Nazarene pin that reminds us of those who have been so brutally treated, let us continue to pray for them and with them. Someone else want to lead us in prayer now? Go right ahead. Remember, if you've already prayed, you can pray again. There's no limit. Hitchhiker, are you still with us? Would you lead us in prayer, please, as a traveler, as one who is aware of those kinds of things? Lead us in a prayer, please.
Impacted because they get a few
amen. Thank you, Hitchhiker. And I would ask you to continue to pray for us here. I want to share a testimony, and then anyone else is welcome to share a testimony or prayer, either one. Yesterday was one of those kind of days that we've all faced from time to time. I'd gotten up early and been on the prayer line and had a real blessing from the prayer line, and then sort of had a down. After the prayer line, I was just doing busy work, and I was sort of down and out and just sort of discouraged. And I heard a knock at the door, and I thought, oh, golly, who is this now? You know, I was complaining to the Lord. Who is this now? So I went to the door, and the man stood there, and about 42, 3 years old, looked at me and said, do you remember me? And I said, well, your face looks a little familiar, but friend, I'm sorry, I don't remember you. He told me his name, and then I remembered, yes, I do remember you. He said, well, I don't know how much you remember about me, but he said, I was with you about 3 years ago. And he said, I was here for about 8 months. And when I came here, I was strung out on heroin, methamphetamines, marijuana, and booze, and I was an absolute mess. In fact, he said, I was about 80 pounds lighter than I am now. And he certainly wasn't overweight or anything, but he said, I was a mess. And he said, you shared with me that all the problems I had, there was one answer. And he said, in all honesty, I thought it was sort of simplistic, but he said, you said Jesus is the answer. And he said, to make a long story short, over the next couple of months, I accepted Jesus as my Lord and my Savior. You led me to the Lord, and I got my life back together, and I got a job. And he said, I want you to know, I just was driving by here on my job, and I thought, I've got to stop and say thank you to Pastor Drake. And so he said, thank you, Pastor Drake. He said, I've been clean and sober now almost 3 years. I've got a wife now. I'm married. I've got a good job. In fact, he was driving a company car. He said, I have a good job, making a good living, and we just bought a house. Told me the neighborhood, and it's not a low-rent neighborhood, it's high-rent district. But he was just praising God, and he said, I give all the glory to God, and I thank the Lord that he saved me, not only in my soul, but in my body and my whole situation. And I wanted to say, and he reached his hand out to me and shook my hand, and then hugged my neck and said, I want to say thank you for being here. And I said, brother, give all the glory and all the credit to Jesus, but I'm sure glad I had to be a part of it. And so, thank the Lord. When we need that uplift, God gives it to us. And what a great testimony that was yesterday. And that's what God does all the time. And we're praying for our sister, Nagme Abedini. Her 2 children are with the grandparents, I think, today, because obviously she cannot travel with the kids, a little girl, a little boy. They're there, Rebecca and Jacob. Someone pray for Rebecca and Jacob, would you please? Mary, are you still with us?
Father, thank you for, you said you'd be a father to the fatherless. Lord, right now she's been fatherless for these 3 years. Thank you for helping her through these years. Thank you for her mom's faith. Thank you that she knows her daddy well, and thank you for what you're instilling within her heart, within her, your plans for her life, how she'll be used mightily because of her mom and dad's faithfulness, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Bless her real good, Lord. Use her for your kingdom purposes in the name of our Savior, Yeshua.
Yes, Lord. And Father, in the 3 years that I've communicated back and forth with Nagme, I have heard several times from the children. I've seen pictures of them. I've heard phone conversations. And I've even talked to them. And in all those communications, only one time in 3 years did I ever hear a complaint. And that was from little Jacob. And little Jacob said, I sure do miss my daddy, especially on my birthday. I praise your name, Lord, that you fill in the gaps when his father's not there. When little Rebecca is lonely, thank you for this dear, sweet, sweet mother, Nagma Abedini, who is both mother and father now for 3 years. And I pray that you'd give her strength and wisdom to say what she needs to say today. In Jesus' name, amen. Anyone else, if you feel led to share, go right ahead. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for this opportunity we have.
Yes, Lord, we do thank you. We glorify your holy and blessed name.
Yes. Yes, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Well, folks, we're coming up on the top of the hour. When we committed to do this, we said we would do it at least 1 hour. So I think what we'll do in about 2 minutes, we'll terminate the television program and the phone call. And then 1 hour later at 12 noon East Coast time and 9 a.m. West Coast time, we'll reopen the prayer line in the upper room prayer room. It's been our tradition now for 28 years to be in the upper room prayer room, and I see no reason to break that tradition today. Not that we have to be so rigid, but we will, in a couple of minutes, close out this hour, and at the top of the hour, we'll reopen the prayer line number. And so if there's anyone else that would like to pray before we go, go ahead right now, please.
In the upper room, in the upper room, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord God.
Amen.
You've given us this opportunity to come in God's presence. Gracious Father in heaven, thank you for accepting us. Thank you for being able to lift holy hands to thee, Father God. We pray, Father God, that you've heard our prayer. In the mighty name of Jesus, amen.
Amen. And everybody go have a glass of orange juice or eat an orange and give God the glory and remind ourselves.